And the moment you start to answer the for what question, you realize that you are now talking about the impact that you can make once you set yourself free from the burden of not having that need met. That is powerful.
Carl, I just want to first thank you for taking the time to come join me on the podcast. It's a special podcast, as I shared with you beforehand, as this will be the last episode of The Pursuit on All About Your Benjamins, because this concept, the topics we're going to discuss, has become so important to me, and the feedback's been so good that I am starting its own brand and its own podcast. So this is kind of the end of The Pursuit. It's not the end of All About Your Benjamins, but just this show, and it's going to move over there. But I've been following you for years, back to my CrossFit days. For those of you who don't CrossFit right now, we're actually in the open season. I don't do it actively anymore, but Carl used to be my go-to on the breakdown. So every week for 5 weeks, there's a workout everybody does. That's how they judge who goes to the games. And Carl was always so kind to break down the movements, give you some cues, tell you some strategy. And I would always watch his videos and try to implement it, and never did it as good as he suggested. But I've been following him for a long time. The reason I asked him to come on is I've noticed lately a lot of his content is running parallel to the things we talk about on The Pursuit. And I thought it'd be really cool to have somebody from outside of finance and begin to bridge this topic in the show outside of my natural network into other people who are having these great conversations, sharing a lot of wisdom. So that's why I asked Carl to come. So Carl, thank you again. And I always like to give my guests the opportunity to do their own introduction, because I could research you, but there might be something that's unique or the way you want to define who you are that I would never know. So if you wouldn't mind, give everybody, you know, an intro to yourself and maybe a little bit about your background.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me. I was just thinking as you were saying this, I'm like, oh, what version do you want, Justin? You know, I can give you.
I want the authentic version. The authentic version. Who is Carl?
So the real version, and the version that is emotionally true in me, is the one where I was a kid who was extremely scared of everything. I mean, I was afraid of my shadow. I was afraid of losing my parents. I was afraid of going to school. I cried every day at school because I just wanted to go home. Mm-hmm. Fearful. And thankfully, I found gymnastics because my mom put me into a gymnastics program after school. And she put me into gymnastics because my dad was a gymnast growing up. And she thought, maybe this could be good. And effectively, as soon as I walked into that gym, something started to open up for me. And the moment I started competing, I found this place of courage that allowed me to be me and mm-hmm. and not be caught in that which I was afraid of constantly. So gymnastics sent me on this trajectory towards just being a student of life, a student of my body, and a student of my relationships. And I went to school, I studied environmental science, and I thought, okay, I'm gonna pursue this career of being a part of collaborating with the planet to make sure that we have a future. But somewhere along the way, I fell into the world of fitness through gymnastics, and I found CrossFit. And in CrossFit, I started talking about gymnastics applied to the practice of fitness. And that's when I started to get some recognition, because I was sharing on YouTube, I was sharing through the CrossFit Journal. As you mentioned, during the open time and CrossFit game season, I was sharing a lot of information, and people were really identifying with it, and they could find some value in it. So that led me to teaching seminars all around the world. Eventually, I wrote a book called Freestyle, and this book did pretty well. And continues to be alive today, 8 years later. And I mean, just over the last couple of days, I've had several people share that they're reading the book, they're finding the book. So it's the gift that keeps on giving. And through the work that I did in Freestyle, although I was talking about physical movement, I've made some deliberate changes since 2017 that now are focused on the practices of emotional fitness, which is basically emotional intelligence applied to one's performance. And that's what I'm doing today. And I think that's why I'm talking to you.
Well, I think there's a lot of things that we could talk about after just our 10 minute talk that I'm going to work in. I made some extra notes to throw some curveballs at you now, because I sent you the agenda, but we're going to add a few things to it. But I want to start off with the transition you made more towards to what you're doing now. So the reason I want to hit on that is one, what led you to make that decision? Because I believe in following passion. So was it passion driven or was it something else? What led you to make that decision and how did you make that transition? And then, well, I'll have a follow-up afterwards. I'll let you start there.
Yeah, the transition started the moment I started coaching gymnastics and movement within the CrossFit space. And what I mean by this is that I already had this sense that talking about movement-specific practices was never going to be enough. That I had to tap into what was happening in the mind, the story that we were telling ourselves, and that I had to tap into that which I was feeling, which was this elevated emotion of just realizing that there is more to oneself than that which we express outwardly in this physical realm. So that started as soon as I started teaching classes within a gymnastics facility or seminars. I already knew that I was going to do that, but it really started to crystallize in 2017 when I had completed approximately a decade of teaching movement-specific practices where I thought, okay, this body of work is pretty complete. I can pass this on. Now I need to start to carve out the next chapter, the next part that is going to complement this body of work. And that's when I started talking about what was happening in the mind and these concepts of emotional fitness. And I started to just gently and subtly start to drop them into the seminar that I was teaching. And I realized that very few were able to connect with it because it felt like it was coming from a different place. It was coming out of left field. It just felt like it wasn't in alignment. So I've spent the last 5 years exploring what is it that will bridge that which is happening internally and that which we are doing externally. So I'm still in that transition. But what is exciting is that slowly but surely, people like yourself are listening and it's resonating. And I think it has to do with the time that we're in. We just went through a pandemic. Regardless of how you experienced it, it has been heavy. It has been different. There has been changes that have come with that, and thus some adaptations. And these adaptations have opened up new spaces within your mind, within your heart, within your body that now need to be filled with something. And what it is, in the first place, in my opinion, is meaning. And something that we are as human beings are meaning-making machines. So I want to help and assist people in assigning meaning to that new space that they have found. And this can be very complicated because if you are the facilitator of assigning meaning, you can easily manipulate that meaning. And this is that fine line that you have to navigate, where you have to encourage self-direction and self-governance. And this is the work that I'm currently doing right now as a coach. I'm trying to help people become more autonomous and to pursue mastery through their own individual purposes.
I think the more you speak on this, it's putting it out there in the universe. And the reason I think we connected and I noticed your new content, because again, I've been following you for years, but to be truthful, I don't remember seeing your post before maybe 6 months ago. Like they were there, but they didn't stand out. And it's that I think we're on the same, you know, whether you want to call it wavelength or frequency, we're on that same plane together. So it's going to naturally put those. So as you put those out, more and more people are going to be, I think, rising to the frequency that we're on. And then it's going to pull people in. And I know that sounds crazy, but I really do believe in it because it's one of those things where, like, if I think of somebody and don't reach out to them myself, within 48 hours, they're emailing or calling me. It's almost like I know they're going to do it. So if I have that urge and I think about somebody, I just proactively reach out now, because if I don't, I know they're going to reach out to me, and I want to beat them to it. So that's not surprising. I don't know if you saw when you were talking about, you know, transitioning, and that was the end of one chapter, but one of my solo episodes where I go on a rant was called Chapters, and how so many people stay somewhere that's not fulfilling because they're afraid of starting something new. And I, on the other hand, maybe am too excited to start something new. I'll quote it here because it's going to be in every episode. Kendrick Lamar is one of my favorite artists, and he put a letter out saying that his next album was his last one on his record label. And there's a quote that listeners know now: it's beauty in completion and faith in the unknown. And to me, that's like, it's great to finish one chapter. You've done everything you can at that level, and now it's time to do something else. And while a lot of people are afraid of that, I think you should embrace it and understand that, like, in that unknown is where the magic happens and good things happen. So I got excited to hear you talk about ending a chapter, because that was one of the past podcasts. So one of the things I want to dive into next is, I highlighted maybe four of your Instagram posts that really stood out to me as of late, because you've got a mixture of, you know, the push-ups and the squats and the movement things, along with the emotional side of things. And the first one was where you start with the Mark Twain quote, and you have these four questions. I don't know if you remember that one. And I kind of just wanted to see if we could dive deeper into those questions. I don't know if you remember those four right off the top of the head. I haven't written out, but I'm sure you do.
According to Mark Twain, the two most important days of your life was, one, the day you were born, and two, the day you found out why. If you look at the people that you admire the most, or the people that have made positive changes in the world, or the people who have added the most value to you, what they have in common is that they have purpose, and they deliberately express it in every aspect of their lives. In order for you to find more clarity in your purpose, you can ask yourself four questions. Number one, what do I love? Number two, what am I good at? Number three, where do I add value? Number four, what do I believe the world needs more of? And if you can't answer that, ask yourself, what do I need more of? If you practice asking yourself these questions, you'll notice that that which you love is fulfilling. That which you're good at gives you confidence. There where you add value gives you strength. And when you bring forth that which the world needs more of, you become of service and thus purposeful.
This is part of Ikigai. I don't know if you've ever heard of Ikigai, but it's the Japanese art of purpose. And in Ikigai, the summary is exploring that which you love, that which you're good at, that which you do in exchange for value, and that which you believe the world needs more of. And when you're able to see that which you love and that which you're good at, you realize that there's overlap there. And that usually defines your passion. Your passion is kind of like your fuel. You were talking about passion earlier and how important it is to pursue your passion. And pursuing your passion is simply stoking the fire that allows your engine, your machine, to keep on moving. And then if you continue to explore that which you're good at and that which you do in exchange for value, you realize that that is the craft, your vehicle, that allows you to become what we would consider a professional. It's that what you do for work. Is that what you do for a living? And if right now anybody who's listening realizes that which they are good at and that which they do in exchange for value is not there in their current iteration or their current life, then there are changes that have to happen. But simply by exploring this, you start to notice what those are. Anyways, when you realize what your profession is, now you have this alignment between passion and profession. And the common ground is that which you are good at. And that which you are good at is usually something that is either an innate talent, that's something that has come to you naturally, or something that you have developed because you're curious about it, because you've been influenced to do it, whatever it may be. But you see that there's an alignment. When there's alignment between that which you're passionate about and that which is your profession, that's when you start to live in this constant state of growth. The problem is that if you don't have this third component, you can start to lose steam and lose meaning. And that's where you have to notice the overlap that exists between that which you are doing in exchange for value and that which you believe the world needs more of. And this is where you find your vocation. And your vocation is the contribution that you make beyond the mechanical exchange of value that you do through your profession, through your work. What this means is that if you are in the business of selling cars, you have to realize that you're not only selling a car, what you're really doing is you're providing a family with a vehicle that is going to make their life a little better, make their life a little easier. It's going to allow them to be more connected, to access more. And when you begin to realize the positive influence that your profession has beyond the mechanics of it, that's when you start to realize that your passion is flowing through your profession and contributing to a larger group of people than you can possibly see or even meet in your lifetime. And this is what completes the body of work. And when you have your passion, your profession, and your vocation, it's like you have the three legs of a tripod. So what goes on top of this tripod? Well, that's where the lens goes, the scope goes, the mission goes. And how do you find your mission within Ikigai? Well, you find it by looking at the overlap that exists between that which you love and that which you believe the world needs more of. And this is where we come full circle. And then once you get to that place of noticing what your purpose is, your mission is, now you can start to find even more clarity within that by asking yourself five questions. And these five questions are very simple. It's who are you? What do you do? Who do you do what you do for? What do they need? And when they get their needs met, what impact does that make? And that, when you crystallize the answer of those five questions, that tripod, that is your passion, your profession, your vocation, starts to really support something of meaning. And this is when life becomes kind of interesting.
Man, I love that. So there's a couple of notes I made, but the last thing I thought of is you said the final question was, how does it, like, once they get what they need from you, how, what kind of impact? And I have a one-word mission statement. It started out with like four sentences, but impact is my one word. I want to make impact in everything that I do, everything from people listening and watching this podcast to when I go check out at the register, I want to try to leave a positive impact on that person at the grocery store. Like, impact's my one word. So I love that impact finds its way into those five questions. I was going to go back real quick to one of the things that I hear people say about their passions, or they're told, we're going to get into other people's influences next, but they're told that their passion isn't, it can't provide the life that they want. You know, you can't support your family following your passion. And I do think there are certain passions out there that might be true. But I think that one of the things you hit on is it's either a skill you already have or something you've developed. And where I think people give up too early is they look at that passion they have. So for me, one of my passions right now is making these mini documentaries, showing people follow their passions. I can't quit all my job, the two jobs I have, and go do that full time. But what I'm doing on the weekends is shooting these mini documentaries, pursuing that passion that I have with no expectations, but I'm practicing. And I don't foresee this being the future, but if I did that enough and I practiced it enough, I could potentially develop the skills to allow it to become a bigger part of my life. And then that's where the side hustle turns into the career. So I really want to encourage people to just, again, pursuing the passion doesn't have to mean it's the focus right away. See where it leads you and see what you learn and see how good you are. And if you really, really enjoy it, keep on doing it. And you might get good enough that you can make that pivot. Or maybe you have a dual income. You've got a semi-career that you scaled back on and you've got this passion. And when those two together create enough income for your needs, that may be enough. Like, we don't have to work the 40-hour a week job anymore. We can have three jobs that are, 15 hours a week and work 45, but be happier because two of them are really heavy passions. One of them might provide some insurance, and when you wrap it all up, you're happy. So I'm glad that you brought that up. Any closing thoughts on those questions before we go to the influences?
No, I think that makes a lot of sense. I do believe that any expression that is fueled by passion, as long as it has the context and ability to meet a need, it can become a profession. Mm-hmm. You just have to make sure that you are timely, that you're able to deliberately direct that practical benefit that your passion brings wherever it has to go, and it can produce something. And if it doesn't produce a full-time job for you, it can catalyze a potential full-time job, or it can become the puzzle piece that is missing within a bigger organization or bigger picture. And it's up to you through your passion, through that mechanical expression of your passion, to identify how that puzzle piece can fit in. And this is where I believe that we need to be able to plug in and be plugged into. And you can only do that if you can see your passion as a physical manifestation that looks like a machine. And that machine is one that makes a positive impact by making or assisting people in getting their needs met, whatever those needs may be.
All right. One final question on this topic that we really need to the next one, because of these videos. I also think that for certain people in certain situations, by going all in on your passion and making that the center, you may realize that this life that you thought you wanted that required a higher income isn't really, like, you're willing to give up some of those things to pursue your passion full time. So in the next episode, Tyler, shout out to Tyler, who does my video editing, he's going to explain this. Like, he give a little teaser. He has positioned his life and his career around surfing. And it sounds crazy, but he's doing a great job. But he is in a position that he can work wherever. And if he wants to surf at any time, he can go do it. And that is his passion. And he's been able to create a life that supports that. Probably is living on less, gave up some things to make it happen. But because he can surf at any moment, that brings him the greatest amount of happiness. And the financial stuff is taking care of itself, which is one of my beliefs, is that if you're doing your passion, two things can happen. One, you realize you need less and maybe your passion can support that. Or two, because you are in that zone, for lack of a better term, doing your passion, you become more productive, you become more efficient and more successful, and potentially that could drive your income up, whether it is the profession itself or, like you said, the missing piece that now makes you more productive or more desirable in a position in a bigger organization. So I thought that I wanted to throw that out there.
But beautiful.
I hit on, or you hit on, limitations from other people. And that was the next Instagram post. It's flowing beautifully, Carl. This is amazing. The next post I hit up was one where you talked about the first sentence in your book, and it's you would change it to let your thinking be limitless, right?
That's me. Life, my friends, can only be understood backwards or in retrospect. And as I sit here reflecting on the book that I wrote, Freestyle, in 2014, I'm thinking about the first sentence that I open up the book with, which is, don't let other people's thinking limit yours. And the reason I had that sentence in the book was because at the time of writing the book, I was being invaded with other people's thinking and thoughts, and it was influencing my ability to put my work onto paper. And as I read that sentence today, I see it almost as a closed door. And if I had to go back in time and change it, I would probably change that sentence, don't let other people's thinking limit yours, to let your thinking be boundless, limitless. Allow yourself to access the realm of infinite possibilities.
At the time you were writing that, you felt like you were being constrained by other people's thoughts and views. And I do think that a lot of people, again, live this life that we're told we're supposed to live, the simulation or matrix, if you will, because that's what they're supposed to, and that's what everybody's told them. But if they were to take a moment and say, well, why am I doing this? And then keep asking why a few times, they might realize that's not really what they want. And they realize that the reason they're doing that is because that's what their mom told them to do or their dad told them to do in society. And we hold ourselves back, and a lot of people hold themselves back, and then they project those limitations onto us. So I wanted to see if I could get you to dive deeper on what your thoughts were about keeping your thoughts limitless and not letting other people's limits or beliefs keep you back.
Yeah. Great question. There's a lot to unpack there, but let's just start with this notion that limits are needed to be able to produce. It's kind of like if you want to create a channel that is going to deliver a message, that channel needs to have some limitations. There needs to be some kind of bandwidth there. And you have to choose what bandwidth is the right amount of bandwidth, what are the right amount of limitations to be able to get that message to whoever you're trying to deliver it to. And this is kind of like legislation or regulations. Here in the U.S., we want as few regulations as possible. But regulations are important to a certain degree because otherwise certain things fall through the cracks. So we do need limits. The question is, are we setting those limits, or is somebody else setting those limits for us? That's one question, and that's something that we need to identify. And this is where this notion of responsibility comes into play, is we need to exercise full responsibility of that which we are doing in this moment and that which we want to do. In other words, to realize that whatever limits are in our life, besides the laws of physics, a lot of those other limitations that we have are in our mind, are in our bodies, and they can be worked out. They're in our relationships, they are in our communities, and they can be worked out. The question is, how are you going to work those out? And this is the work. And that's something that I can't answer for you. You just have to explore. The other side, when you were talking about this quote about the book that I talked about on that Instagram post, I said, don't let other people's thinking limit yours. And the reason I wanted to change it to become limitless in your thinking was because our mind doesn't know negatives. So in other words, when you're reading that that quote, don't let other people's thinking limit yours, what you're really reading is, do let other people's thinking limit yours. Mm-hmm. And the irony here is that I, in the book Freestyle, was trying to encourage people to take control of their own physical practices, and at the same time telling them that you should follow some of the rules that I'm giving you. Mm-hmm. And that's the paradox. And this is where practice comes into play. And practice is a set of limitations that we put on ourselves in order to identify that which needs to be identified. In other words, to identify the needs that we need to get met in order to continue to grow. And this is where it can get a little tricky. It's that every practice, as much as it can serve us, eventually stops serving us and can become a trap. Mm-hmm. So we need to become aware of when a practice is helping us, when that practice has been integrated into our system in a way where it becomes a habit, and become aware of how it's assisting us in moving forward. And through that awareness, realizing that the limitations that we have set through the practices, as much as they are giving us, there is a certain point of time where they stop giving. And in that moment, we need to have the courage, the rationale, the support, the resources to let go. And this is detachment. And this is what we are all very scared of. It's letting go and not knowing what is to come. And this is what you were talking about in terms of Kendrick Lamar, is having faith that the future is going to be bright, because that which I have learned, my experiences, are going to serve me, are going to assist me in transcending into this new chapter, into this new level.
I feel like now is a good time to introduce the listeners to Ram Dass. I haven't spoke about him yet on the podcast. And truthfully, I've been listening to the podcast. I've watched the Netflix special a couple times. So I'm really, really new to it. But it's kind of interesting. Again, I think it's frequency wavelength stuff, that I log on to Instagram when I'm eating lunch and I see that you posted today about Ram Dass. So here I am. My journey's taking me to his work and learning about him. And the man I'm getting ready to interview in 25 minutes is posting about him the day we're... I thought it was ironic. And I think that maybe we'll take a break real quick from the videos and just kind of maybe give people an introduction to Ram Dass, what he's meant to you, and the understanding that you have that you're applying to all this. Because I hear a lot of his work and his sayings and what you're talking about now. So you don't have to give his bio, but just maybe more of like who he is and what he's meant to you, and how his work has kind of found his way into the way you view what it is that you're doing in just life.
Yeah. So Ram Dass was his name was Richard Alpert. He was this is just a brief bio for those who don't know, but he was a professor in psychology at Harvard. He started to explore psychedelics, and eventually he got kicked out of Harvard for this research that he was doing. And he went to India to try to figure out what all this meant, because when he was exploring with psychedelics, he had this moment where he was able to separate himself from who he thought he was. And This is something that he wanted to learn more about. So he went to India to explore, and eventually he found his guru, whatever that means. And through his guru, he was able to get access to these teachings. And he came back to the U.S., to the West, basically, to share the importance of breaking down that which we consider a religion, which is a tie, and be able to unite us in a collective consciousness, which is simply becoming aware that you as an individual are always connected to other people. And in his teachings, of course, he talks about different practices from different religions, from different spiritual practices, with the intention of simply showing people a path to, you can call it liberation or detachment, to feeling okay. And Ram Dass came into my world simply through exploring the mind. And when I started listening to him at first, I was like, oh, this guy sounds crazy. I'm not a religious person, although I went to Catholic school. Maybe that's what got me to not become religious. But I went to Catholic school. I haven't had real spiritual practices, nor have I identified with any of it. But the way that he was speaking to me resonated deeply. And one thing that he said was one that the quote that I shared on Instagram, which was that my only job is to work on myself as an offering to you, to those that you serve, and to work with others to continue to work on myself. That was one thing. The other thing he said that was very interesting was that he joked to his students and he said, if you listen to all my tapes and all my lectures, you will eventually become as neurotic and paranoid as I am. In other words, he was just saying, I don't know what I'm really talking about. I just feel that this is helping me and it's helping others. And there's something here for all of us. So might as well lean in and see what it's revealing. So that's kind of how Ram Dass came into play in my life.
Okay. Well, I'm certain that he's going to probably pop up some more as the pursuit continues to go. So it'd be a good introduction, especially here on the new channel for it. So I thank you for that sidebar and giving that introduction to people. And I'll link to the documentary and to the podcast. So if anybody wants to learn more about it and listen to it, they can. Going back to the post, and one of the next one talks about deliberate effort and creativity and feedback.
Hello, my friends. How are you? Today, I want to share something that you already know, but maybe you and I need a little reminder of this. And what it is that anybody who cares about producing positive outcomes and seeing progress and growth, we all need to put in a strong effort. We need to do hard work, but hard work only gets you so far. What you need to add to it is creativity. Creativity is being able to approach it from different angles, different perspectives, and doing this with the vulnerability, the open heart, the willingness to seek out feedback, especially the feedback that doesn't align with how you think and how you do things, as this feedback is the one that gives you the insight not only to do strong work, not only to do creative work, but the best work that you can do.
I'm most interested in creativity and how that plays into the work that you're doing, helping people, but just kind of also how creativity fit into your personal journey and how important that is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, creativity is an interesting one. My mom has always been an artistic person. In fact, she is technically an artist. That's what she does for a living. She's a painter. Mm-hmm. And I've always seen what creativity looks like in her, but I've realized that creativity expands beyond the arts. It's something mm-hmm. that we utilize on a daily basis to find that which allows us to be as authentic and original as we possibly can be. And this can happen in the form of speech that we use, in the way that we decorate our homes, in the way that we design our lives. But in order to get to a place of creativity, you have to be willing to participate in the nature of nature. And what does this mean? Well, this simply means to express yourself. When you express yourself, you start to identify that which resonates with you. Something that resonates with you is something that when you do it, it feels right. You feel connected to it. So the nature of nature is something that when you start to participate in it, it starts to show you who you are. Like you're, mm-hmm. it shows your true colors. It shows the character that you truly have underlying all of this mess that is your thinking and your feelings and all of these things that people in the spiritual world may call the veil. Mm-hmm. And when you are participating in this natural progression, eventually you realize that through experimentation, you begin to create these methods, these ways, these pathways. And these pathways are something that you could consider a formal expression of yourself. This formal expression of yourself, what's beautiful about it is that it's tangible. It's that which people can identify and they can choose to move towards it, away from it, against it. It's that which is clear in the world. Mm-hmm. And then as you continue to explore that which is formal, eventually you start to push on the edges and you break through. And this breakthrough can come when you least expect it. And this is the change in who you are and what you are doing. And this sometimes, for people who are listening right now, is when you have an impulse that comes up for you that is greater than your programming, that is greater than your conditioning, that is greater than all that which you do on a consistent basis. It's that day where all of a sudden you see the world different. The moment you see the world different, you do something different, and you realize that there's something there, you now have changed forever. That cannot go unseen.
Right.
And this is the creative space. And something that you can do is you can practice creativity by setting limitations, as we talked about earlier, like having a blank canvas and saying, I'm going to paint something on this and I'm only going to use charcoal. But in my opinion, it's something that we shouldn't be pursuing. We should simply be it. Mm-hmm. And this is where there's a difference between going down the pursuit of something versus the creativity of something. And what do I mean? Well, the pursuit is the rat chase. It can become the rat chase. Mm-hmm. The creativity side is the side of attraction. And this is where I say create and attract. What does this mean? This simply means be who you are, do what you want to do, and notice what you're attracting. The attraction, that which you are attracting, that which you're bringing into your field, is pursuing you. And that's the true pursuit. People mm-hmm. think that the pursuit is outward, but in reality, the pursuit is inward. And how do you do the pursuit inward? You simply are. And that's exciting, because that means that you can do anything that you want. Mm-hmm. Anything. As long as you're doing it with what spiritual practitioners would call ahimsa, which is without doing any harm, with nonviolence. And man, and just, this is where it gets really exciting.
Yeah, you just totally changed the meaning of my show, man. I love it, though. It makes sense. I mean, it's like the energy you put out is the energy that seeks you. It's why people who are constantly negative continuously have bad things happen to them. Like, it's not creative, but like I guess maybe it is. Their energy is creating the continuous negative things that happen to them. Mm-hmm. But I like that the creativity is just being mm-hmm. who you are and letting that happen.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have any comments on this, but I feel like people have a hard time either A, understanding who they truly are, or having the confidence to be that individual.
Mm-hmm. Both.
Any advice to like, how do you work through that?
Yeah, I mean, I can tell you right now that I feel this very often. I forget who I am and I start to get caught in that which is manifesting itself in my life. And I think, oh, I am this. But in reality, that's not the truth. I'm simply the observer of this. At the same mm-hmm. time, I do have responsibility because I have manifested this. I have participated in making this reality the reality that it is. Mm-hmm. And here, there is a place where we must practice giving ourselves a little bit of grace, a little bit of give ourselves a little bit of slack here. Because a lot of that which we are creating, we're doing unconsciously. Mm-hmm. And this unconscious expression of ourselves is that which we need to meet. We need to start to go in and reflect on and feel. And we can do this in many different ways. We can sit down and meditate. We can have a breath practice. We can have a movement practice. We can go out for, you know, a run, hang out with friends, and simply be and allow whatever is happening right now to simply be that without having to control it. And in this place, it's where you become the witness of who you are in relationship to what's happening. And whoever's listening right now may think, okay, this sounds very crazy. But it's simply the rational observer. Sorry, the irrational observer, the one that is not trying to rationalize what is happening, that one is at peace. That one isn't suffering. It's not experiencing the consequences of the reality. But it does have the power, that observer does have the power to deliberately create a new reality, to change the reality that one is living in. And when you are able to break through into changing what is currently happening in your life because you have that ability to witness it, that's when you start to build a little bit of confidence, because you notice that you can do it. The problem is that you're going to go to bed tonight, and tomorrow you're going to have to remember this. So the practice, the true practice of building confidence and being able to be yourself, be original, be genuine, is one that you have to remember. Mm-hmm. And that's it. That should be the focus. So if you have a moment of clarity and you're like, oh yeah, my thing is impact, I'm going to write impact down and I'm going to place it right next to my bed or on my desk. And every morning when I wake up, I'm going to go look at that word and I'm going to say impact. Oh yeah, that's who I am. I am the embodiment of impact. Mm-hmm. And when you embody that which you are complete. You are more authentic, more genuine. You are what you could say or call, you are aligned. You are in coherence. That which is in your mind, in your heart, in your body is all moving in the right direction, in the same direction. Mm-hmm. That's where it is.
This is all stuff that I've heard before and have learned myself through experience. So I think that you said, some people listening might think this sounds crazy. And I often say that because I almost feel like it's like a disclaimer to say like, it's okay to think this is crazy, but the goal of telling these stories and writing and creating around this is to plant seeds. Like you and I can't force somebody to understand and believe this, but if people hear it enough different ways, a story may resonate with them, or they may have their own moment of clarity. And then they think back to this conversation and the light bulb goes off. Or it gives them confidence to go further into that moment of clarity because they heard it before. So I oftentimes say it sounds crazy, but we can't. It's because we can't force people to realize it. We can only just put it in front of them and let them understand it when it's time for them to understand it. My hope is that we can help people understand it sooner rather than later, because I feel like it's game changing once you get it. And the other like disclaimer I always throw out is this whole conversation about, you know, embodying who you want to be and it happening, it doesn't go without like the hard work. Like my fear is like when I talk about this, people think about, oh, you just want to be something, you close your eyes and wish for it. Like, no, that's not it. You've got to know who you want to become and embody that now, but you got to put in the reps and you got to put in the work to go that direction. So it's like, it's both things come together. And I think where sometimes people get lost in it is it just sounds like, oh, you just want that. It becomes it. Well, no, you've got to do the work to get there. And it's never a straight path. And it may not always manifest itself in the exact vision you have. But then once you get there, you realize this was really where you're supposed to be. Like it's close, but there's some little subtle differences. And those differences matter. And you don't realize it till you get there.
Yeah. If I could add to that, for one, that last little bit is very important, is that which you wish for can happen, but you better be very specific about how you want it to happen and how you want it to look, because it's going to happen, but it may come scrambled. it may not look exactly like you thought it was going to be when it arrives, but nonetheless, when it arrives, acknowledge that it has arrived and be like, oh, I did this. I created this. I just didn't realize that I was missing a few pieces or the structure in my mind wasn't correct. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing, is realize that whatever you want to achieve, you possibly can. It's just not going to look the way that you thought it was going to look. And when that happens, simply acknowledge it, work with it, and then create the next iteration of it. And it's the iterative process that we must go through. That's kind of like ascending the spiral staircase. You're going to always go around and around, and you're going to feel like sometimes you're just going in circles. But in reality, you're elevating yourself. You're growing. You're progressing. Mm-hmm. That's on one side of things. And I know we're being kind of philosophical here and kind of just abstract in our conversation, but I also think it's really important that people realize that this these practices, this conversation has work, like you said. And the work is the mechanics. It's the techniques. It's the expressions. It's kind of like in business. You do have to have your finances in order. Mm-hmm. If you don't have your finances in order, you can't move the machine in the way that you want it to move. You have to be resourced. How are you going to deliberately put into play your financial strategy? What does that look like? Then what does it look like to run your organization? What does leadership look like in your organization? Does it look like more communication? Does it look like creating a calendar that everybody can follow? These are systems, and these systems are the work. And I think that's really, really important that people realize that just because we're having these fluffy conversations that feel good, feel exciting, and are kind of interesting, it doesn't mean that they're not attached to something very mechanical, very practical. And if you cannot translate that which is abstract to the mechanical, that which is precise, then you're not there yet. And that's one of the reasons we're having this conversation.
Mm-hmm. I think it's an important connection to make. I couldn't help but think about when you're talking about the scrambledness of it. I think it's in Aladdin when they like Aladdin makes his first couple wishes, like they don't, or other like genie movies where you wish for something. And the genie brings you that, but it's not exactly the way it is because you didn't provide enough details that he filled in the gaps with whatever he wanted.
Right.
You have to be very precise with it.
Exactly.
The final post I wanted to go through is actually from, it was on my birthday, and it talks about purposeful action and find what's alive in you and go into that.
A question I catch myself answering during podcast interviews, for example, is, Carl, why do you call your lifestyle coaching practice lifestyle design? Well, for me, it's very simple, and it's because design is a deliberate, intentional, careful, and critical thought process for making decisions. And when I think about design, I use three super simple questions, which are, is this feasible? Meaning, is this even functional? Can I do this? Is it possible to do? The other question I ask myself is this viable? Meaning, is this something that is sustainable? Will I be able to do this for a long period of time? Can I automate this? Can I make it a habit? And finally, the most important question that I ask myself in terms of designing something is this desirable? Is this something that I really want? Is this something I'm going to care for and that's going to add value to my life?
To me, that is, I think passion can have a bunch of definitions, but to me, what's alive inside of me and going into that is the passion. Like, again, I shared with you, like I'm driven by passion. I can't do anything that doesn't excite me, or I don't want to. And I've worked really, really hard to put myself in a position that as an entrepreneur, I don't have to do anything that doesn't excite me and I don't have passion. And I explore a lot to see, is this really a passion or is this an interest? And sometimes interests turn out to be passions, and sometimes interests are just interests, and I experience them. I see what it's like to be that version of myself and realize, yeah, that's not it. And I pull back and I go on to the next thing. So maybe have you go a little bit deeper into like the purposeful action and kind of finding what's alive inside of you.
Yeah, so I guess where my mind goes immediately is to the becoming aware of what is resonating or ringing inside mm-hmm. of you. And mm-hmm. this is the aliveness, so to speak. And if the aliveness right now is telling you, hey, I need to get on this podcast and listen to it because I'm just itching to hear what Justin has to say, then that's...
They want to hear what Carl has to say.
Well,
maybe that too.
Who knows? But if somebody's listening and they're like, I want to jump on the podcast and I just want to listen, that's something that is alive in you. The exploration of what's alive in you is going to help you identify that which you need. And when you say that which you need, immediately, this sounds ridiculous, but the world, people, the universe conspires for you. They start to work for you in order to help you get these needs met. It's kind of like if you wake up one day and you're like, I have back pain, and you tell your partner, I have a lot of back pain today. I don't know what's going on. Maybe your partner's like, how can I help you? Can I bring you like a warm rice bag? Or do you want me to rub your shoulders? Or can I give you some tea? All of a sudden, your needs start to get met by your environment. Mm-hmm. So identifying what is alive in you is really identifying that which you need. And when you are able to speak that which you need, I need more money. Then you start to get those needs met. And this is where, all of a sudden, if that which is alive in you, which is a need, doesn't start to come your way, you're going to start to ask yourself, why? Why isn't it coming my way? And if you ask yourself, why isn't my need getting met? That's when maybe if you just sit a little longer, you'll realize that there's another question that's missing, which is for what? Mm-hmm. And the for what question is, I need more money, or I want a massage, or I want to feel good. Okay, for what? And the moment you start to answer the for what question, you realize that you are now talking about the impact that you can make once you set yourself free from the burden of not having that need met. Mm-hmm. That is powerful. And when you can live in that place where you realize that the reason you want to be healthy is so you can do more, so you can serve more, so you can be more, all of a sudden those pains start to go away. When you realize that you want more money so you can create more, you can access more, you can share more, all of a sudden you become financially healthy. Mm-hmm. And this is something that I've struggled with so much because there is this... story, this narrative that exists that money is equal to power and power is bad. Thus, it's not morally right for you to have money. Ooh, you're making too much money at once. That's other people don't make any. Why would you deserve to have this money and not somebody else? That's the narrative. And being able to filter through that narrative, to start to identify not only what is alive in you, but rather what is it that you need and for what, now you begin to make meaningful change. And that brings you to a state of completion, succession, mm-hmm. progression.
We all have those money stories. And, you know, I shared with you before we started recording that, you know, for a long time, I was afraid to make a goal of mine to make more money. I wanted to, you know, obviously I would like to make more money, but I didn't want to focus on that because I felt like that was bad. I was being greedy. So just do the right thing and things will work out. And it always did. But over the last year, year and a half of kind of the exploration I've done, I realized it's not bad to make wanting more money a goal, especially if the reason for wanting more money is to do good things. You know, some of it may be selfish. I want to take better trips and more trips with my family and you know, be able to spend more money on podcasts and do things like that. But a big part of it also is I want to help people. Like, I would love to be in a position where I find out somebody has $10,000 of medical bills that they're swimming under, keeping them from having that burden lifted, and just be like, I got you. Wipe it clean. You know, they're saying I need money for this burden of paying these medical bills. I could do X, Y, and Z if I didn't have these medical bills. I would love to be the person that takes those medical bills away to give that person the freedom to go do the next thing. And once I realized that making more money and making that a priority, doing it a good way, causing no harm, as you said earlier, is not a bad thing. And then my wife is in a women's group for entrepreneurs because she owns her own business. And the lady leading it said, you know, there's a finite amount of money out there. We'll take the Fed printing money out conversation out of there. There's only right. so much money in the world. It can either go to good or bad people. And if you as a good person can get more of that money and then go do good with it, then it takes more of the money away from the bad people who are going to do bad things with it. And I really thought that was like, I've never looked at it from that angle of like, I'm going to do good things, so I should have more money than somebody who's going to blow it on silly things or not use it properly, which I thought was a really cool thing to think about, allocation of good dollars versus bad. So, but we all have those money stories, and it's different for all of us. And that's one of the things I've learned as an advisor is it's okay to have those money stories, but being self-aware of them and understanding them is the first step to addressing them, to get over those hurdles so we don't hold ourselves back. We don't put limits on ourselves in an area that we shouldn't.
Yeah, that's I love it.
I want to kind of take these concepts we've talked about now and kind of parlay into what it is that you're doing. And I hate asking the question about lifestyle design. Like, one of my goals as a podcast host is to make my guest's experience on my show different from everybody else's. So I would love to talk about different subjects or ask different questions. And I really try to do that. But I know the lifestyle design question is one you get on every, because that's what you're doing, but it's different. So if you wouldn't mind going down the definition of lifestyle design and what that is, and you've got the three aspects of it, and maybe hit on that. Because I want people to also, you know, you've shared a lot of great wisdom and expertise and knowledge with us. It's only right that people know what it is that you're doing. So if they want more of this, they know what it is that you do and how you might be able to help them. So kind of tell us a little bit more lifestyle design and what those three aspects are.
Yeah, the lifestyle design is very simple. It's simply becoming aware that you can create whatever life that you want for yourself. Yes, everybody has a different starting ground, and thus it may not look the way that you are envisioning at the moment, but you can get the resources, access to the resources, you can experience the feeling that you envision, and that can come from practice. And you were talking about the different aspects of lifestyle design, which is, for one, it's asking yourself whether what you're trying to design, what you're trying to create is feasible or not. Meaning, is it even possible? Are the resources out there? How do I get them? Where are they? The second one is viability. It's realizing that there has to be sustainability of those resources. Whether it's your time, people, a skill set, money, whatever it may be, it's a resources. Is that resource there and accessible to you? And the most important one is desirability. And desirability is really asking yourself, is this really what you want, or is this what you think you want? Thus, you need to act. And the action is, okay, you were talking about this earlier, is am I just interested in this or am I passionate about it? Well, right now I'm interested in it, thus I'm going to pursue it. And over time, I'll realize if I'm passionate about it or not. And sometimes that interest can lead to passion, but that passion may start to fade over time because something else in your life is not complete or needs your attention. And this is where the exercise of awareness really comes into play, and self-reflection, which is at the core of really living in a way where you're constantly growing, you're constantly progressing, you're constantly tweaking that design. And that's where you have chapters, of course, to your lifestyle.
All right, let's keep on going down the work that you're doing and talk about the experience, the course that you have in May, which I'm 99% sure. I got to check the calendar. I think I'm going to sign up. And but before we get into it, I love the fact that you're accepting crypto as a payment. So I told you that this week that we're recording, my last day was at a startup. Mm-hmm. The startup was a company building the platform for financial advisors like myself to help their clients with crypto.
Amazing.
So I'm deep into crypto. I love it. So the fact that like you're accepting crypto, I think is really cool. And also good for you for being ahead of the curve of everybody else. But let's talk about the course and less about crypto. Maybe we'll have you come back on and you can talk about crypto in the future. But
yeah,
talk about
to.
The course, because I think it's pretty cool.
Yeah, the course is called The Interface Experience. And the premise of it is to learn how to interface with yourself. And the interface is your body. It's your mind. And it's getting access to this through the different practices. And the practices that I share in this course are basic meditation and breath work. It's nothing fancy, but it catalyzes a conversation that allows you to develop the skill set to interface with yourself. basic movement practices, which is learning a new skill, and basic writing practices, journaling practices, which is bringing out that which is in your mind in a verbal form, a written form, that you can just put on a piece of paper and look at. And then finally, there is the creativity side of things, which is manifesting into something physical that which is alive inside of you. And this can be a business, this can be a piece of art, this can be anything. And through these practices, what we do is we explore what it means to become emotionally fit. And emotional fitness, as defined by myself at this moment, is our ability to move into a state of being, a state of mind, a state of heart, a state of body, a state of being that translates into purposeful action. So on one side, it's an ability, it's a skill set, it's something that we can learn, we can practice it, it's something that has techniques. And on the other end, there is purposeful action, and purposeful action being our ability to be deliberate in our expression. And this comes through exploring four phases of development, four stages of development. Number one, the stage of just expression. Just showcase who you are. Say whatever, do whatever. Then the next stage is experimentation. This is when you deliberately start to choose your expression. Then you enter the stage of integration. This is when that which you have deliberately done is giving you feedback. You're getting numbers back. You're getting results back. You're feeling something. And this is where integration happens. And in the stage of integration, it's where you are reprogramming yourself. You are restructuring, reorganizing. And what's exciting about this is that expression is chaotic. And that chaos happens to be self-organizing. It shows you what to prioritize. It shows you where things are landing. And that's what makes you deliberate in your expression and thus allows you to experiment. And those experiments allow you to integrate. Once you get to the point of integration, now you have to get to the point of letting go of that which you have integrated. And that's when you enter the fourth stage, which is transcendence. You move on, you open a new chapter, you open a new book. And that's where it gets really exciting, because now you can forget that which you have learned and know that you can remember it whenever you need to remember it, because it's there for forever. And this is what we do through the four-week interface experience. And it's been a roller coaster of a ride, but wonderful to experience myself as a teacher through it.
At some point, somebody has to figure out a way to take all of this work and be able to break it down to a level that, like, I can teach my 11-year-old. Like, I want my boys. First off, I think they probably already know this at a young age, like that innocence. And then we get conditioned and we lose it, and now we have to find it again. But one of my goals as a father is I just want them to understand all of this before I did.
They
hear me talking about it enough, so hopefully they do. But then I also want them to use it, because I really do look back at what you just described is what I do all the time. The experimentation that, like, I do that for so much of my life. I didn't know that. And even as recent as a few years ago. And I feel like if I would have known that earlier, I could have used that to my advantage sooner, but then I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you and, you know, butterfly effect type stuff. So
right.
I just think that these are really important principles that I would love to get kids understanding sooner, or allow them to tap into what they already know and not lose it. Mm-hmm. It's like flexibility. You look at a toddler squat. Today, I get all the mobility in the world. My ankles and hips are so tight. Like, I can't even get down to a low squat without, like, stretching and warming up. Mm-hmm. But I started out being able to squat down to the ground, ass to grass, with no struggle at all. And then you lose it.
Right.
So, the other thing I wanted to make sure that we plugged, I love how you've kind of structured access to you. So you've got the experience, but you also have is it Insider Circle?
That's what it's called, yeah.
Kind of the community. Talk about the community as well, because I have a feeling that there's going to be people who listen to this, it's really going to resonate, and they're going to want to have more of it in front of them to keep them going. Because it'd be easy to listen to this episode and then go back to life and never put anything into motion. But if you can be a part of the community, or you can do the course, it keeps it in front of you and moving down that path.
Yeah, great point. So yeah, so the Insider Circle is my members community, and it's a place where people can come in and simply continue to connect with me and that which I'm working on. And right now I'm doing a couple things within it. One, I have these lectures that I'm giving every month. I give a little lecture on different topics. Two, I have what I call Coffee Club, which is we get together and people actually get to interact and talk and share their ideas. Three, people can share what they're working on and what they're excited about. You also have access to a few movement programs that I have there. And then we have this little corner or space, we call it, where people can jump in and they can put up a video of them working out or doing some movement and ask for feedback. And I jump in there, or somebody in the community does that. And it's something that is constantly evolving. It's something that I'm playing with. So yeah, that's been pretty cool to have, and I'm constantly thinking about different ways of making it that which people need. So that's kind of in development as everything else is, but that's the one that is really right now scrambling and becoming something. But it's adding value, and I'm excited about that. And the Insider Circle is really just this opportunity to stay connected to some of the ideas that maybe we started talking about through the interface or in one-on-one coaching that I've done or through podcast conversations like this one. And I think it's important for me to say, too, that as I'm sharing all this to some people, I may sound very clear, but I'm trying to figure it out as I go. I'm doing the work, the exploration. I'm creating as I speak. Thus, I'm allowing that which I'm sharing to show me what needs to be worked on. And mm-hmm. I think when I share this because it's important that people can connect with me. This is important for me. That people can connect with me as a mirror for themselves. Not as somebody who's there to tell them what to do. Although sometimes I put my coach hat on and I say, this is what's going to happen. You're going to do 1, 2, 3, and then we can talk about next steps.
Mm-hmm. Well, from one community builder to another, if you haven't already figured out, I think one of the things that makes a real community strong is empower the community. So that eventually the Insider Circle, it's great to get access to Carl, but the real value is the other people in there and the idea exchanging and the support and the accountability that goes on. And it sounds like you get that, but I just throw that out there from one community builder to another. And I love that. And I love your comment about not being a mirror. One of my, I'll call him a mentor, a friend of mine who's really influential on me when it comes to this. He said, everybody's just a mirror. And we're all like, the reason you don't like somebody is not because you don't like that person. There's something about them that reflects you that you don't like. Mm-hmm. And everybody is a mirror for us. And we're constantly looking at everybody that's really a reflection of ourselves, which is really hard to grasp. But I think once you sit with that for a little bit, it makes more sense. Like an example, and then we'll kind of wrap up. I get extremely frustrated. I'm not proud of it, of my oldest when he plays basketball. He's very talented, but he's very emotional. And he gets upset on the court. And when I was coaching him this season, he talks back to me. And I get mad at him, not because he's, you know, making a mistake. I'm getting mad at him because I would never talk back to my dad. I would never talk back to my coach. And I'm getting mad that he's doing that, but it's a reflection of how I am and what he's not living. It makes sense. I did a crappy job of explaining that, but when you sit with the fact that...
No, that makes a ton of sense. I love it. And, you know, what you just said is actually really powerful because... this is what the exploration, this is kind of like the youngin style is kind of like, okay, well, you didn't talk back to your dad. Did you do that because you respected him or because you were scared of him?
Right.
Mm-hmm. If it was fear, maybe what you have now instilled in your son is a sense of safety that allows him to speak mm-hmm. what he's feeling. Thus, you have done something a little different. You have instilled mm-hmm. security. Now, how do you instill respect? Mm-hmm. And that's where self-respect starts, and then he can mirror self-respect to you. That's exciting.
That's awesome.
That's exciting. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah, that you... You got my mind running. I don't even know what to say right now because I've never thought about it from that perspective. That I didn't view it as we instilled that safety in him. It was more of that I spoiled him, but it's the same. It's not that different. Like spoiling him is giving him the safety to be able to feel that way. And it wasn't fear. Oh, the thing I was rudely interrupting you on is there's a friend of mine. He's a past guest. He tweeted this week talking about like, how do you want to be remembered? Mm-hmm. And I was going to ask you what you want your legacy to be, but I don't think we have enough time for that. But I know how I want to be remembered professionally as I sit today. But what I didn't know, and I have to sit on, is how do I want my boys to remember me? Like, what's the father? I don't want to be the father that they're afraid of. But like, what do they think of me today? And is that the version of myself I want them to think of me? And then what do I need to do to try to be that dad I want them to remember me as?
Yeah, and I don't think that's your choice.
True.
We don't have a choice of how people are going to remember us. People are going to choose for us. Mm-hmm. And that's what we need to let go of and simply acknowledge that this is who we are, embody that, mm-hmm. and do it in a way that I've said earlier feels right in our head and our heart and our gut. And when we do that, we're doing the best that we can. Mm-hmm. And if we're willing to change along the way, maybe we will be remembered as those who made mistakes and were able to redeem themselves. Maybe we will be remembered as people who were meaningful contributors. Maybe we will be forgotten immediately. Regardless, I don't think it's our choice. And that is liberating in itself.
Man, the last 2 minutes of this podcast just like has been amazing. This podcast is for me, not for the listeners. And that's part of the creating, is just talking through this stuff. But I'm joining Insider Circle and I'm taking the course just so I can hang out with you more often, just because I really feel like that was just really meaningful to me. So I appreciate you going there and saying that, because I think that's something that I'll play back and listen to this as I'm editing and really sit with that and getting to the point where I can let go of that. Like letting go of some things is very easy for me. Like I can move on and compartmentalize, but letting go of the impact I want to have on the boys and realizing I can't control that, that's hard. And my prediction is if I can get to the point where I can let go, then it'll be the result that I ultimately want, because I'm not trying to force it, would be my guess, or it'll be closer to that vision.
Yeah, I'm totally with you. And I think that's something that I'm heavily working on too. I mean, I'm a grandpa right now. You know, I have a grandson and I have a daughter. Mm-hmm. My daughter's 23. My grandson is 13 months. And the letting go is such a hard thing. I have to trust. I genuinely have to trust that I am doing everything in my power to hold the space that they need to be the version of themselves that they can be. And that's all I have to do. And I just need to be consistent yet firm in the way that I do things and have my boundaries, but also be boundless in my contribution to their lives in the way that I am in alignment with and in a way that I feel connected to and truly embody as a contribution. And for that to happen, I need to be listening more than I'm speaking. I have to do less. And that is liberating too, because that means I don't have to try anymore. Mm-hmm. I just have to be. Mm-hmm. It's amazing.
Two ears, one mouth, as they say.
Right. And here I am saying it with such confidence. But then, you know, the next minute I forget and I have to remind myself. And that's the trust. I have to trust.
All right, I'm going to skip the usual drop your social medias. If you're listening only on the podcast or you're watching on YouTube, All About Your Benjamins, it'll all be there. Because I want to get to a fun question. It has nothing to do with what we talked about. But I love music. You came in while I was jamming into one of my records.
Yeah.
If you're a speaker, you're going out to speak to an audience, what is the walkout song you're going to have? What's the song you'd have play?
Oh, boy. Well, there are a couple that come to mind. It depends on how I feel. If I'm feeling joyful, it's Johnny B. Goode. If I'm feeling like, hard and like, ah, here we go, it will probably be Eminem's Not Afraid.
Okay.
Yeah.
Solid.
Yeah.
Solid picks.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we're bumping up against time, and I want to steal like 5 more minutes. So selfishly, I'm going to cut this off
so I can
ask you a couple other questions about some of the endeavors I have and kind of synergies I see for the future. But I want to thank you again for giving us well over an hour of your time and dropping all of this and exposing people, I think, to some new ways of thinking. And also, I believe, giving people the confidence to keep going down the thinking they might be afraid to. I think there's people in both camps. So I appreciate you being vulnerable and sharing all this with us. Again, I'll have the course, the community, all that stuff linked to. But just want to thank you for your time and sharing yourself and your knowledge with us.
Yeah, thank you for having me, and thank you for letting me be myself.
Definitely. All right, everybody. Well, thank you for tuning in and watching. Likes, shares, all of those great things. And instead of ending with keeping on the pursuit, we'll keep on doing that. But I want to steal what Carl just said and encourage you to just keep on being and being yourself. And we'll see you all in the next episode. You can try and read my lyrics off of this paper before I lay them.